Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's on-series session titled Mates Helping Mates. The topic and expert speaker is brought to you by the Office of Industrial Relations. As a department, we are committed to driving initiatives across the whole scheme that improve safety, well-being, and return to work outcomes for both employers and workers. My name is Alicia Bailey. I am the Manager of Engagement Services for OIR, and I will be the facilitator for today's session. Just to let you know that we anticipate today's session will go for approximately 1 hour, and all participants will be emailed a copy of the presentation following the session. Before I hand you over to our expert speaker for today, I thought it would be valuable to provide you with some insight as to why the Office of Industrial Relations is focusing on improving the education available to support our stakeholders with the management of both mental health and psychological injuries in our Queensland workplaces. The Office of Industrial Relations is responsible for the administration of overall scheme performance data. This includes work cover and the 28 self-insurers. This data provides us with the opportunity to identify reoccurring and emerging trends within the Queensland Workers' Compensation Scheme. So what we know, based on the data from the 2015 to 2016 financial year, is that there were 4,273 psychological and psychiatric injury claims lodged. These claims represent approximately 4.6% of the overall claim lodgements for that year. Now, when you look at these statistics in a graphical representation, like the graph on this current slide, it is apparent that these injury types are not predominant when compared to other injuries more commonly experienced within the scheme. However, this slide shows a different perspective. In the last financial year, the average finalised time loss claim cost for psychological or psychiatric injuries was just over $50,000. This is almost three times the average cost when compared to physical injury claims, which was just short of $17,000. We commonly hear through our engagement with stakeholders that many employers in rehab and return to work coordinators rely on statistics related to the average work days lost in terms of measuring their performance and outcomes for their particular organisations. So this may be of interest for many of you. For psychological and psychiatric injury claims, the average work days lost was 156.8 days, my apologies, compared to 49.4 for the overall scheme. The comparisons in the latest data highlight the disparity in the impact that psychological and psychiatric claims have on an injured worker when compared to physical injury claims. We really hope that sessions like today provide you with practical and innovative strategies that you can implement in your own workplaces to help you influence successful return to work outcomes for any worker who has experienced a mental health issue or a psychological injury. Today's session is really an introduction to the issue of mental health in the construction industry. Mates in Construction will be delivering a few follow-up sessions in the coming weeks that will explore practical strategies that can be utilised in a rehabilitation and return to work context. So with that being said, I am pleased to hand you over to today's expert speaker. Jorgen is the Chief Executive Officer for Mates in Construction Queensland, and we are extremely pleased to share his experience with you today. So thank you, Jorgen.
Thank you very much. The expert bit sort of rattles me. I'm really much more here to, I suppose, share my experience and share some of the things we've learned in the construction industry in dealing with mental health and well-being and suicide prevention. So I'm absolutely thrilled to be here, and I'm even more thrilled that you are wherever you are and you've taken the time to be part of this discussion. I'm just going to work out how to actually... No, just a minute. So it doesn't, okay, yep, I apologize for that. So this is the first of a few webinars we're going to do over the next few weeks, and today I really want to start talking about what we know about suicide prevention and mental health, and share with you a little bit about the model that we have used in the construction industry to deal with the issue. So It might just be worthwhile just starting by having a bit of an overview about mental health. What we know is that about 1 in 5 Australians would experience a diagnosable mental health condition over a 12-month period. And 45% or more of us would experience a diagnosable condition at some times in our life. So it means that mental health issues are generally out in the community. OECD have estimated that poor mental health at work alone costs developed countries such as Australia 3 to 4% of our GDP. PricewaterhouseCoopers worked it out to be about $11 billion a year that we are losing in workplace across Australia. They said about $4.7 billion due to absenteeism and $6.1 billion through to presenteeism. About $146 million a year is paid out in workers' compensation claims for poor mental health. So it's certainly an issue. In some research that was done in the coal industry found that 30 to 45% of the absenteeism was in some way linked to poor mental health. And they estimated that about 1.5% of their output overall was lost due to poor mental health at work. So it's a big issue. Some industries have higher incidence than others, and we know some of it. We don't know all of it. The construction industry is one of the industries that have been identifying as having higher rates of mental stress than other industries. There was some study done by Bert Bix at University of Queensland, QUT, a few years ago that looked at, for instance, drug and alcohol use that worked out that about 58% of the construction industry in that sample consuming alcohol at hazardous levels, and about 15% of them were consuming alcohol at levels that was likely to cause significant physical harm. So all of these kind of things are obviously linked to mental health. I want to talk a little bit about about the most serious in manifestation of poor mental health, which is suicide, because at cases poor mental health can be fatal. In doing that, I just want to put it out there, because of course I don't know how your day have been so far. Some of us might not have had a good day. So if I can just sort of put a plug out here before we start the presentation, that there's a phone number, 1-300-642-111, 1-300-642-111. That's a 24/7 helpline, and I'll give you the number at the end as well. So just in case if some of the stuff we're talking about here sort of hits a little bit too close to home, it's always nice to have someone to have a chat to about it. So in Australia, we lose about 6,800 people to suicide each year. That's a suicide every 3.5 hours. That's a fair bit. And when we look at the World Health Organization's estimations, we can extrapolate that to say that we have about 7,100 people who are permanently disabled following a suicide attempt each year. So we're talking fairly high numbers. And of course, suicide is not equally prevalent everywhere. For instance, we know that 3 out of 4 suicides are by men. That's not to say that that all men are doing it hard, because women are actually more likely to attempt suicide than men. But when men are suicidal, unfortunately, it's more likely that the outcome could be fatal. So it's a quite serious thing. Just want to break that down a little bit and just sort of try to see how relevant is that actually, and how relevant is that to us in our own organization, our own industries and workplaces, as an issue we need to be concerned about. When we do the math, and we have 23 million people in Australia, we can work out that roughly 1 in 8,000 people would die by suicide each year. And when you look at that, to me, I don't see 8,000 people over a year. That's not really that much at first. But a few years ago, I went and saw a football game, and it was real football. It was soccer, and it was a grand final, and the Brisbane Roar was playing. And of course, there was 55,000 people there, and that told me that there would be about, five or six or seven people who watched that game with me that day, who wouldn't share the despair of the following year's season with me. So it sort of started making it a bigger issue than you first think. We know that suicide is underreported. Coroners actually have a presumption against suicide. Suicide is a reason for dying. It's not a cause of death, and coroners are really looking for the cause of death more so than the reason. So quite often, unless it's very clear from the circumstances, we won't put something down from a suicide as a suicide. Some people say it's 20% underreported. Other people say it might be up to 50% underreported. There's also other reasons for that, and we do that sort of out of consideration for the family and people around, because there's a lot of stigma around suicide. We talk about committing suicide like we commit fraud or we commit crime or we commit a sin. It actually harps back to times when suicide was illegal. If somebody died by suicide in a few hundred years ago, the family wouldn't actually inherit the property. They'll go to the state because they couldn't benefit from the proceeds of a crime. So we've actually had a period where, and our language still reflects that thing, that suicide is wrong and is sinful and stuff like that. So that makes it really difficult for people who are doing it tough and could be suicidal to actually talk about it, when that sort of sits in the way we talk and think about the issue. We know from research that about 1 in 500 would attempt suicide each year and would need medical treatment following a suicide attempt. So when we look at that, if we have a sort of medium to large size workplace, we should actually statistically expect that we have a suicide attempt every year. And again, that makes it something that we actually need to relate to as a place where people gather, as a workplace is. The other thing that was highlighted, Suicide Prevention Australia put a position statement out about workplace suicide prevention a few years ago, and they highlighted that researchers show that up to 17% of the suicides were actually work-related. So when I apply that to construction, that's about 30 suicides a year that is somehow work-related. The other thing we know is that thoughts of suicide is quite common. Research have shown that when we go out to ask large populations, can you recall having thought about suicide over the last 12 months? Roughly 1 in 20 will actually be able to recall having had suicidal thoughts over the last 12-month period. So we put that into context. Half of us might experience one in five of us might experience a diagnosable mental health condition, but 1 in 20 of us could actually be so stressed that suicide become one of the options we consider. Luckily, most people who think about suicide don't attempt suicide, and even less of them die from suicide. That's a really good thing. But I suppose the thoughts of suicide is a little bit like the oil lamp in your car. You're driving along and the oil lamp starts flickering. That's not a good thing, because it tells you that something's seriously wrong with your car, but it actually gives you some options. So you can choose to stop your car and top up the oil, get it serviced and so on. And thoughts of suicide are very similar to that. It's a sign to us that we need to stop and take stock and look at what's going on in our life and start dealing with it before it becomes any worse. Now, the last bit is that poor mental health is a safety issue, and it's a safety issue for a number of reasons. It's a safety issue because if we're struggling with mental health issues, like a crane driver I was talking to once, we did a presentation and he sort of showed signs of being a bit stressed about it, and I put him aside afterwards, said, "What's going on, mate?" And he said he had lost his son to suicide only 5 or 6 months before that, and the stress of it had sort of caused his relationship with his wife to break up. So he was sitting in this little one-bedroom bedsitter, and they started the lawyer's game. So he was absolutely broke. And he said, "Every time I sit alone, all I see in front of me is pictures of my son and what sort of mess I'm in." this guy being the crane driver was actually responsible for picking up tons of steel and move it around the site while he was not all there. I would say every single worker on that site had a vital interest in this guy looking after his own mental health and well-being. So we know that people who are mentally stressed are actually more likely to have physical injuries and physical accidents than people who are doing well. We also know that people who are mentally stressed takes longer to recover from physical injuries than people who are in a better mental space. We also know, so as I said before, 17% of the suicides were somehow work-related. We also know, of course, that work can affect our mental health. We know that some industries have higher stress levels. We know that some industries have higher suicide rates. So that tells us that there's some sort of link between work and mental health the other way as well, which of course puts on us some responsibilities in terms of our duty of care to the workforces we are dealing with. This is a little bit about what got us into what we were doing in the construction industry. This is a study we released earlier this year with Professor Chris Dorn from the Honda Medical Research Institute that looked at suicides in the industry. And they identified that suicide rates in the industry was about 32% above the national average for men in Australia. So remembering already 3 out of 4 suicides were done by men. So shocking. The good thing is it's getting better. One of the things I with some pride point to is when we look at that stats and we look at Queensland, well, we're evil pecking now with the male suicide rates. It wasn't like that 10 years ago. 10 years ago, we were 30% above as well. So what we have done as an industry have actually shown that as a workplace, we can have a real impact on saving lives in terms of suicide and suicide prevention. but still, this equates to 191 suicides in the construction industry each year. That is one every second day. We also know that we lose about 30 workers to accidents at work each year in the construction industry. So in context, we lose 6 workers to suicide for every worker we lose to an accident. And we all know when you work in the industry is a dangerous industry where we need to take safety really, really seriously. Guess what? We need to take mental health safety seriously as well. And when we apply that 17% statistics, if we apply that, we actually end up with 30 suicides which are potentially work-related, which is the same number of people as we lose to physical accidents. So certainly something that's worthwhile considering. This might be a little bit of a callous way to look at it. We know from the research we did that suicidal behavior in the construction industry costs the community $1.5 billion per year. But it costs businesses more than $25 million a year in terms of lost productivity and things like that. And that's all well and truly. But if you talk to a workplace where you have lost a workmate to suicide, if you talk to somebody who lost somebody to suicide, you'll know that this money just doesn't even get close to actually describing the real cost of a workplace suicide or a community suicide. So I suppose that is a little bit of painting the scene for the issue we're trying to deal with. So what we are dealing with is we're trying to deal with suicide because we know that we can't deal with suicide without also dealing with mental health. Mental health is the bottom of the iceberg. Suicide is the top of the iceberg. But we have designed our program specifically to be suitable to the workforce we are dealing with. So let's talk a little bit about the workforce and then we can talk a bit about what we know and how we dealt with it. So when I'm talking about the construction industry, I'm sure that you could pictures in your mind a bit like this of hardworking men sort of toiling away. And if you're a little bit more realistic, the picture might be like that. A lot of the time, we work together really well as an industry, and we're really cool because building is a collaborative process. But at the same time, we also an industry that have conflict where we often play pretty hard between each other. Sometimes our work sites are small building sites where we just work with a small crew, just putting a house up here, a house up there, or repairing a bathroom, and other times we work on really large scale industrial projects. So we had to work out if we were going to interact with our industry and make a difference, what is actually the core principles, what are the things that sort of ties together, how can we design a program that is acceptable to everybody in the industry and works with it. So considering all of that, we worked out about four key principles. One of them was that we had to be independent. So we had to be we had to be an independent charity. We had to have the unions liking us. We had to have the employers liking us. We had to have the workforce liking us. So we had to work out that we didn't step anyone on anyone's toes and that we respected everyone in the process. So we were designed specifically as an independent charity. So with that in mind, we never sell our services. An employer can't pay Mate to Construction to do the program on the site. We only give it away for free. We then like when people like us enough to give us money, because that then supports the program we're running. And so far the industry have been generous enough to keep the organization going. We use industry structures. We thought that going out to a bunch of men and start talking about mental health would be hard enough, so we on top of that then had completely different structures and different ideas, well, the task would be just about impossible. So we aligned the program very closely to the safety structure, and you will probably recognize that as we go through the program, so that every step of it we actually know already, and we know it works, and we generally accept that, you know, it might not be perfect, but it's the best we got. We target men. That's not to say that we don't have women in the industry, but we do have the blue-collar workforce, which is the workforce within our industry, which is of particularly high risk of suicide. They are 98% male. So we devised our communications so that they were specifically acceptable to men, but still accessible to women. So we talk about suicide as a changeable problem, because as men, we like to fix problems. That's the gift we've been given. You know, I come home from work and my wife will tell me about the door that I need to you know, the sticks and all the kind of things that need to be fixed, and I would much try, and try is probably the operative word, to fix it. So that's what we naturally do. So when we get to a point where our life needs fixing and we can't fixing it, that's actually quite a hard realization to come to as a man. So we deliberately talk about suicide because that is a very tangible problem, whereas if we start talking about mental health, we might get mental pictures of sitting around in circles without shoes on and things like that, and that doesn't come natural to us. We don't ask men to seek help because we're not very good at it. You know, it's not what we naturally do. And everybody would tell us that most doctors are visits are by women, most counselors visits are by women. Women are much better at asking for help than we are. So we decided, well, let's not target that. Let's target what we are good at instead, and we are good at offering help. So we have this ethos of mates, you know, men, mateship in Australia, where you sort of have a cultural duty to look out for your mates and have their back. So we'll put into that instead to say, what does it actually look like when somebody is struggling, and then how might we help them? And we find that we're much, much better at that. So it's really about mates helping mates when we boil it down.
Can I just interrupt you there?
Yeah.
We hear quite regularly from our stakeholders that initiating conversations about return to work when they're suffering or have suffered from a mental health issue or a psychological issue is a huge barrier. People don't feel empowered to have that conversation. Would you say, based on the model in how you've changed this approach for males, which is different to the approach for females, is it just a language difference in the way that you sell the program and you sell the concept of mental health and the concept of suicide, or is it the actual physical approach that you adapt? Is it the way you go out to males and speak to them physically or remotely or however you do it? What's the main difference between the male and female cohorts?
I think that men likes the peer-to-peer stuff. we have particularly blue collar men. We might have an unhealthy, a healthy sort of disrespect for professions, and so we like to speak to other men. I also think, and I probably want to talk a little bit more about that in the next webinar. And sometimes when we find discussions about mental health difficult, it's actually much more about ourselves than it is about the person we're talking to. So it's often much more about how we feel about mental health that is a blockage for us having effective communications with other people about mental health. So that's probably some of the things we just want to touch a little bit on next seminar. So how do we actually have an effective conversation about somebody who's experiencing poor mental health? And I think the starting point is actually looking at ourselves rather than the other person. Did that answer your question? Okay, thanks a lot. So to come back to that idea about, firstly we saw in our industry that it appeared that we had high suicide rate. We saw that through our redundancy trust, we saw that through our super schemes where a lot of the death payment appears to be suicide related. So we then engaged with an organization called Australian Institute for Suicide Research and Prevention out of Griffith University to do the biggest occupational study that had been done at the time into suicide within the industry to find out what we actually saw, whether it was true, and then at the same time giving us some indications about what the right thing to do about it would actually be. So we got that research done, and I just want to share with you a little bit of some of the things that came out of that. But particularly what we're really doing in the Mating Construction Program, we're taking the recommendation of that report and saying that is what a bunch of people who know a lot about suicide prevention thinks we should be doing, so we better do that, but we better do it our way so that we do it in a way that we actually buy into and we accept. So the study found, similar to what I reported to you earlier, that our suicide rates were much higher than average, and that particularly our young workers were of higher risk of suicide. But also found that of the people who died by suicide in our industry, half of them had actually told somebody about their struggle and about the difficulty they were facing, and a quarter of them had actually attempted suicide before. So there's actually people out there waving flags and saying, I'm struggling, but I don't quite know what to do about it. And still they died by suicide. So we said, well, if we could actually do something about that, if we can change it a bit, because what we found is of the people who died from suicide, only 7 out of 100 had actually sought professional help. So if we could increase that sort of 7 to 50 or 30 even, we guessed that we would actually have a significant impact on the suicide rate within our industry. So we just think about it. Half of them had actually thought about suicide, a quarter of them had attempted suicide before, so they had clearly tried to tell us that things weren't good, but only 7 out of 100 had actually attempted suicide, that has actually got professional help. We also out of that, at the time, I was a trade union official at the time, so we asked the union, can you just tell us what's wrong, because then we can put a ban on it and we can fix it. Except that the type of issues we got back on wasn't the issues that was easy to fix for us. This slide here sort of recommend that that's a version of the type of issues that was identified by workers in the industry who died by suicide. So life events, these were the type of the most significant event that happened in people's life just before they took their own life. So relationship problems and legal matters and financial problems, all those kind of things, but they were not particularly construction related. So it wasn't actually something we could really do something about, we felt. We also went to the workforce and said, what are the type of issues that you feel are the most, the strongest barriers for your quality of life? And they highlighted issues like longer working hours, a culture of alcohol use, bullying behavior, and suddenly we got a lot closer to the workplace issues. And when we actually then started putting those together, we could then see there's a strong link between them. So, you know, relationship problems rarely come on its own. We often say it'd be great if I could just say, this week I'm having my relationship problems and I'm having my drug and alcohol problem next week and my financial problem the week after that. It's not like that. It's one thing on top of another on top of another. And suddenly people tip over and they can't deal with their stresses. So it was much more those kind of issues we had to address with. Yes.
I guess I just wanted to build on that point. I think it's a fantastic point that you raise, that even though these particular triggers may not be specifically a cause of work itself, I guess you've come to the realisation that we are always managing individuals in a workplace who actually are experiencing these life events. So there has to be some awareness of the life outside of the desk that we sit in or the truck that we sit in day to day to actually manage these triggers and accept some onus of control, that it is part of our duty of looking after our workers from a safety perspective, but also managing how they actually respond to these triggers, even coming back to the workplace as well, and the implication that injury can have in actually causing some triggers like this for an individual.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think we come to work as whole human beings. We don't come as a work part and the private part, and we are not that easy to. And of course, the things interact. If you have had a tough day at home, you're going to be less patient with your supervisor when you go to work, and vice versa. So all of those kind of things completely interact, and we can't separate it. People do come as whole people, and it does influence each other. So that was why we said we're not going to look at it whether it's a workplace issue or whether it's a home issue. We're going to be completely blind to that. What we're just looking at is people doing it tough. If we can actually identify people who are doing it tough, we can then start dealing with the issues one by one and trying to separate it out, so we get it into manageable chunks before suicide become one of the issues. So if I can just talk a little bit about the model we chose to use when we say, how do we actually engage with the workforce around this, and how do we actually get people on board with looking after mental health and looking after each other? This sort of is a bit like the contract we had at work. For a long time, we had this idea that, if I go to work and I don't tell you, then you don't have to tell me, and then we don't actually have to do anything about it. And that sort of workforce, except it didn't, because it showed up in our suicide rates. So if we imagine here's Fred, and Fred is going to work, and he's having a tough time, a bit of troubles at home, he might be drinking a bit more, there might be issues at the job, might be running out, financial problems, all the types of bits and pieces that all adds up, one thing on top of another. He'll go to work and everybody's going to say, well, you're a bit odd today, but on we go. We're trying to break that down. So the way we do that is we start by saying we go into a workplace and we have a discussion with everybody in the workplace, from the project manager to the builder's laborer, from the subcontractors to the employees of the principal contractors. We only do it if everybody comes together. And it takes about an hour. And we talk about suicide as a preventable problem. We all have a role to play in dealing with. We talk about the tip-over points and the type of issues we talked about before, how one thing on top of another on top of another can lead us to tip over. And then we say, what does it actually look like when one of your mates are tipping over? How might you pick it up? And how can you connect somebody up to help? So once we've done that, everybody get a white sticker, because stickers are really important in the construction industry. We need to have hard hat stickers. So we get a white hard hat sticker and we put that in our hard hat, and that shows all of us that on this side here we actually look after mental health. This side we have this sort of collective contract that that mental health is one of the things we're looking after. Now, now the sites look like this. That means that Fred is still going to work and his life is no better than it was before. But chances are now that one of the people around him might pick up that not all is well. And of course, we only need one to pick something up, but if we have everybody aware, chances are that somebody's going to pick it up. But So when we do this general awareness training, the other things we ask people to say is that this is an issue we need to face as an industry. Do you want to be a volunteer with Mates in Construction? Do you want to be a connection point on your side, where somebody can go to if they're concerned about one of their mates? And on average, we get 20 to 30% of the workforce volunteering to become connectors. With those lists, we then go back to management and we say to them, here are the people who are volunteers. How do we make sure that we get a good coverage of the workforce? We need to make sure there's an apprentice there. We need to make sure there's a supervisor there. We need to make sure there's a union guy there. We need to make sure there's a project manager or an office person there. So everybody have somebody that we can actually relate to ourselves. We often say when the project manager is going through a separation, he's not very likely to go to one of the apprentices and say, my wife has left me. And similarly, the apprentice is not going to go to the project manager and say, I can't actually handle my drug and alcohol. So people are more likely to go to somebody that they find at their own level. So we said make sure that we have connectors distributed across the site so everyone have access to one. So we try to get about 1 in 20. So out of those 20%, we get about 5% that we then train. And we're not concerned at all about getting the wrong connectors. We have plenty of the wrong connectors all over the industry. That's not important at all because workers are smart enough to work out who to go to and who not to go to. What is really important is we need to have enough of the right ones. So by getting 1 in 20, we will have right, and you know, we will have the right connectors on site that people can actually find. In that, we're using a Canadian model called Living Works to do that, so that we actually could use something that other people had already developed, which made it a lot easier for us. Been tested. We come back to site and we give the connectors the connector training, which is about a four-hour training session. And we talk about what is your role. So how do you actually manage your role as a connector? And you might have conflicting roles because you might also have a role as a supervisor or as a safety guy or whatever. How do we actually manage those conflicts when those roles are in conflict and how do we deal with that? How do you look at yourself? Because often the people who volunteer are the people who are the carers, the people not people normally go to anyway. So if you are the type of person that people would normally use, it's actually important that we look after ourselves in an organized way. We give them this Safe Talk, which is a module that deals with how do we actually approach people around suicide, how do we ask them about suicide, how do we have a conversation around it, and how do we connect people up to help. And then we induct them into what actually happens when they connect up with us, because they're part of us now. Once they become volunteers, they're actually part of Mating Construction. They do this as Mating Construction volunteers rather than employees of their employer at that particular time. And of course, that means in our industry where people change jobs all the time and they go from one employer to another, they take their hard hat and they take their role with them. And that means that the program automatically moves from site to site with the workforce organically. And again, the stickers, important. You get a green sticker. So that means everybody with a white sticker knows that if I've got doubt about one of my mates, I just have to find a guy with a green sticker. So now the workplace looks like this. An important part of that is that I might have a white sticker and I notice that my mate is not doing too well. But if I don't feel that I'm comfortable in dealing with it, if I don't feel I'm right to have the conversation, I might then actually choose to ignore it or walk past it. But if it's really easy for me to actually do something about it, I'm more likely to do something about it. So therefore, having connectors in the workplace makes it really easy because all I have to do is just go and talk to a connector. So that's the part of it.
I particularly like this model because I think in a rehab and return to work context, Jorgen, a lot of organisations have a dedicated rehab return to work coordinator, which I'm sure you're familiar with. They are often seen as that conduit between all parties involved with managing this person to successfully get them back to work. I think the value in this model that you've presented today shows that there's a lot of power in expanding outside of that role in terms of support, so that employees particularly might actually consider adopting this type of multi-support person or multi-prong, I guess, approach just outside of the rehab coordinator, so they still fulfill their duties and requirements in managing the return to work. But the worker has this visual and, I guess, quite transparent support network around them as well to give them more options on how to talk or where to go if that particular rehab and return to work coordinator is not the one that's maybe suited for their needs to help them overcome whatever barrier. So I think there's a lot of, I guess, impact, and there's a lot of value in having such a huge network like that. And a sticker is so easy. It's, I guess, quite funny to see how trivial and a sticker could be in influencing this change in a workplace.
Absolutely. And I think it's important to that thing that people need to have choices, because there might be some issues that I am 100% comfortable going to my workplace coordinator and my return to work coordinator or my supervisor or my, and there might be other issues I would desperately not want to do that with. The choice we're having is not, we can't force people to go to any specific person. So the alternative is that people are in the workplace unsupported, So it's much better that they are supported by some external source, so that they continue at work and they actually we maintain their mental health going forward. The last bit of this model is what we call assist workers. So if we remember how we talked about using the safety structures, when we look at the general awareness training, that's not too far from the site inductions. In our industry, we're used, you will not get on the site until you have done the site-specific inductions. And we do site inductions 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times a year. Every time you start a new site, and we'll go and there's a toilet, and this is what we do on this site, and all that. Some of it we've heard hundreds of times, but we just know that this is part of doing business in our industry. And general awareness training is really the same. People do it on site 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times. And each time we do it, it's just about actually getting this commitment that this is actually what we do in our site here together. We look after mental health and well-being. The connectors are not completely dissimilar to our safety committee. We, particularly in construction where things change all the time, handrails are missing, walls are going up, walls are coming down. It's not a static workplace. We know that we have safety people we can go to when the handrails are missing. So we can, and connectors are no different to that in practice. So it, culturally, it's quite clear that it's simple. And the last bit of this is, of course, the assist workers, which is our interveners, the first aiders. And assist, you can best compare that to physical first aid. It's a really good comparison. I go on site, and if you could see me, you would see that I would be a fair risk of a heart attack. I go on site, I have a heart attack, and I'll trust the builder's laborer to give me CPR. Here now, and if he doesn't, chances are that I won't survive. I prefer if he didn't do the open heart surgery, and that's what doctors are doing. But if we don't have that on site, I won't make it. I won't get the second chance. And mental health is no different to that. For some people, getting that help where they are at the time can be life-saving. So having assist workers, again, they're our first helpers, first aiders. It's a two-day workshop where we talk to people about how do we actually talk to somebody who's suicidal, how do we make a judgment about whether they just need a Band-Aid or whether they need to call the ambulance and go to hospital or whether they need to go and see the doctor. Same assessments are made quite safely within the assist framework. And how do we support them ongoing? So we then encourage work sites, particularly larger work sites and remote work sites, to have assist workers. So within that framework, we can then we then have a self-contained model on site. They can, this site can do their own thing or they can use us. We're totally happy with both sites. It's about actually building resilience into the workplace. One of the things we said when we started was we didn't actually want industry to become reliant on a charity like us because one day we might lose our funding. And then people say, well, where are they? We actually want the place to be a better place because we've been here. So it's about building resilience rather than dependence. Yeah, yes. So once we've done that, we then, the site looks like this. So Fred is still doing it tough. Somebody notices it. We can actually deal with something. A connector goes and seems, hey, mate, you're not doing too well. Let's go up to the first aid office and have a talk to the assist worker or whatever. They can make him safe. They then refer on to the services as is required. We provide case management, so people who feel that that's the best resource for them can actually go with a case manager and then say, all right, how do we actually cut this down into smaller bits? And then we hook people up to existing resources wherever. So it might be that the case manager say, well, have your employer got an employee assistance program? Yep. Well, why don't we talk to them and get some counseling? Or, you know, if you're going through a separation, why don't we go and find legal aid? Or whatever we might can do, we might be able to do to help change the situation, to take a bit of pressure out of it so people can manage their stress at that time. We also operate a 24/7 hotline, which was the number I gave you earlier, where volunteers, our connectors and assist workers can call in and get support, but also individual workers can call in and get support with it. The last bit is that sites who meet our minimum standards, so that is that everybody on site have received the general awareness training. 1 in 20 have been trained as connectors, and there's access to a suicide first aid resource. We then accredit that site. So that means the site gets a certificate, they get a call flow sign to put on the front gate and a little thing they could do at inductions. And that sort of means that on this site, we've done our bit, or we've done yeah, we're committed. And of course, that's not too far from safety audits and safety policies, and all, and a number of the companies have actually adopted that internally to say, we want all our sites to be accredited, and now the local management then have to work with us to get to that that level, and we're sort of keen to do that. So that's sort of the model. Another way, and I want to do this relatively fast, but I do want to go through another way of looking at the model. And that is from the person's point of view, from the person who's struggling, particularly men, but I think all of us actually. Going to work, we're struggling. Work is one of the last things we give up because that's where our finances sit, that's where so much of the hope for all the stresses we are sit in our work. So we're likely to actually continue working right up until we can't stick together one in one piece. In Australia, we actually have lots and lots of good resources. So there's lots of help out there, both through our employer, through the system, through the state, all those kind of things. We have lots of good things happening out there. But it's not necessarily, when people go home from work, we don't normally Google psychology. It's often things that goes into the search engine. So the distance to the help become almost insurmountable. Having people inducted means that there's somebody around you that you know personally that can actually pick up and say, mate, you don't look right. Having a connector means there's somebody who can actually start the conversation. Having an assist worker, there's actually somebody who can connect you up. So what we have done is we have effectively built a bridge between the person who's struggling and the help, whatever it is, and we find that that is actually what people are using.
Jorgen, can I just ask you a question based on your experience? And I don't know if you even have a story that you could relate to this, but we hear quite frequently from rehab and return to work coordinators, we know that our stakeholders are quite proactive and committed to getting workers back. And one of the main barriers that they often experience is that the worker themselves doesn't want to connect with the services or the support or the resources that is readily available to them. So I guess this model shows that you have quite an in-depth level of support or different avenues, but have you ever experienced when a construction worker or someone in the industry is struggling, it's known that they're struggling, but they're just not willing to engage with the help that the program and that the organisation is offering, how you've overcome that or if that even happens?
All the time. That's not uncommon. We popularly call them frequent flyers. We're people who keep coming back to the program time and time again, and we talk to them about the need to deal with the drug and alcohol. We talk to them, and they come again. And that's frustrating, but it's also great. You know, I can't make people change. I can only be there to pick them up when they fall. And if I'm there, then I might be ready for when they are prepared to change. That's not a similar situation to somebody who's doing a return to work, but quite often the question is why? Why is somebody not prepared? Because people want to do well mentally healthy. People want to recover from the injury. Nobody want to be injured. So the question is really, why is people not engaging? And that's probably the question we need to look at. I have spoken a lot, and that means that I've spoken over time, which is not uncommon either, and that means I won't bore you with any of the statistics. So what I will do is, any of you are statistical nerds, I'm quite happy to, they will be part of the presentation anyway. Really what I much rather want to do is to see whether there's any questions, and most importantly I want to, if any of you are have sleep deprivation, there's a bit of a list there of resources if you want to read more about it. Not about sleep deprivation, but about us, and the help number I talked about before.
Thank you, Jorgen. While we get our participants just a couple of minutes to put your questions through, everyone listening, feel free to put your questions on the Q&A box in the bottom right-hand side of your screen. Just while they come through, I think I might just take this opportunity to let everyone know that the Office of Industrial Relations has developed some other webinars and resources in the mental health space that you may find of interest. There's a couple that are found on that URL in the screen, and the topics are listed below. So over the coming months, October and November, we will be expanding on the topics in psychological and mental health, and how to manage them successfully in a return to work space. I'll also take the opportunity to let you know of the Injury Prevention and Return to Work Conference, which is on the 19th of October this year. The details are on the screen, but of interest to you are three particular topics that we've made sure specifically focus on mental health, well-being or psychological injury management. So they're on the screen as well. So feel free to jump on and have a look at those. We're getting quite a few questions come through, so Jorgen, if you're happy, I might just shoot these over to you. Are you aware of any particular career pathway programs that integrate this awareness as part of the training, you know, such as apprenticeships or traineeships?
What we're doing is we're doing what we call the master's toolbox specifically for apprentices, where we take through the general training and the connector training as part of their apprenticeship. So that's a 24-hour toolbox particularly designed towards young workers. But I want to make it clear that what we actually look at this, we look at this as a community development program rather than training. So the important thing is actually what people do with the training, more so than the training itself. So we actually think it's important that it's done in a workplace, in an older workplace, rather than some that becomes a skill.
Great. I'll just read. Based on your experience, are many of the suicides that you've particularly seen in this industry presented by Indigenous workers?
Our industry have a relatively small proportion of Indigenous workers, so statistically I can't actually tell you. I can tell you that we have Indigenous clients, and we obviously know that suicide rates are very, very high in the Indigenous community. But I can't actually give you any statistics. We haven't got it broken down to that level where we've been able to give you anything on it.
One of the participants has identified that the Northern Territory has a zero construction suicide rate. Now, I know that you're within the Queensland jurisdiction, but do you have any knowledge of what's happening in the NT space in regards to suicide in workers?
Yes, I have, and we would release a report next week. So here's a scoop for you. But it's not actually true. Northern Territory have high suicide rates in the construction industry, and Northern Territory have high suicide rates generally. So that would be, watch this space, there'll be a report released next week on our website that looks on suicide rates in the construction industry between 2001 and now, broken down state by state compared to the male average. It's statistically, I hate to say it, but there is suicide within the construction industry in Northern Territory, and it's quite high.
Can you advise participants, if they were interested in engaging the Mates in Construction program, how do they actually go about doing that? Is it simply a matter of contacting you directly, or what's the best method?
Within the construction industry, it's a simple phone call, and we'll just come out and do it. Outside the construction industry, it's a little more complicated. In the mining industry, we are currently running a pilot program, but because we are an industry-based organization, we're happy to give our program to any other industry who want to run it. But our qualification in doing this is that we're a bunch of construction workers. So when we go into an office environment, we just won't fit in. So it's about actually finding something that's suitable to that industry. But we're more than happy to help, and we're more than happy to share any of the knowledge we have in this space.
Fantastic. I'm sure a lot of people will be very pleased to hear that. Now, I think we had a difficulty with your microphone for the first question, so I'm just going to ask it again, just to, I guess, pick your brain about if you had any awareness of if these types of programs have been integrated into career pathways, such as traineeships or apprenticeships.
As I said, we are running what we call the Life Skills Toolbox, and that is a program that is available not only to the construction industry, but to any young worker within the state, that integrates the connector and the GET training with a number of other life skills as well. Generally, we don't look at the program as a training program. We look at the program as a community development program. So we actually think that it needs to be delivered as a package on site rather than through the training program as it is now, because it gets its power from being something we do together as a community.
Based on your awareness of the rate of suicide, are you able to give any comment of if there's a particular subgroup within the construction industry that this is likely to affect, such as trade or ethnicity or socioeconomic status?
Yes, actually we have some really good data on that comes from Deakin University and looks at skill levels, and it tells us that particularly high suicide rates amongst the labourers and the operators, so the lower skilled occupation within the industry. When we come to the trades like plumbing and electrical, the rates are actually relatively low, possibly even below average. And when we go to the more senior, the engineering occupation, there's a slight kick up in suicide rates as well. So if we actually want to focus on where the rates are highest, we need to focus on labourers and operators and the lower skilled occupations.
I guess that's great. You can drill down that far, actually, so you can target your program and actually develop strategies that are relevant to that particular cohort, which is good to know. Are you aware of any particular program similar to Mates in Construction for the manufacturing industry? I guess the impact that Mates in Construction has had is quite evident in a positive way. So do you know if there's anything similar for employers in manufacturing that they could access?
There's a number of organisations that work in the same space. One of them called OSHELP, the other one called Connecticut. They are different programs. They run a program called Lifeboat, which have the different components. But in terms of an industry approach, there's only been about two or three other examples in the world where we have actually taken an industry approach like we have in the construction industry to a level where we've actually been able to provide evidence that we're effective. So there's good tools out there, and that's but without any false modesty, there's not a lot of places where we've actually been able to tie it all together on an industry basis that we have in construction.
Now the stats you've presented today, I guess, are overwhelmingly, I guess, a lot bigger than probably most of us expect in terms of incident rates. Do you have any insight as to why this particular issue isn't heavily public in media and those types of avenues?
Yes, I think it's the same reason why we call it committed suicide. There's still a lot of stigma around it. We lose 2.5 times more people to suicide in Australia than we lose to traffic accidents. That wasn't always so. We actually had, it used to be opposite in the 1970s. Traffic accidents have come down dramatically. We've got better cars, we've got better driver education, we've got better policing, better paramedics, all of those kind of things have actually driven it down. Suicide have remained stubbornly high all the way through, and it's by choice. It is because we have chosen not to deal with it, because in the instances where we have done something, so for instance when we limited access to guns following the Port Arthur massacre, suicide rate dropped. When we implemented the National Suicide Prevention Strategy, suicide rate dropped. In the construction industry, suicide rates have dropped quite dramatically when we did it. So the reason we have high suicide rates is because we've chosen to, not because we have to.
So I guess that really highlights the need for the community to work collaboratively at all levels to actually influence change in this space. And I guess I'm proud to announce that later in the year, the Office of Industrial Relations is engaging a mental health ambassador, I guess, to help in this space as well. My apologies. So we're looking forward to hopefully having some positive influence over the coming months and over the next year. Now, I'm aware that it's 1 o'clock and we don't like to keep people longer than we should, so we might have to leave it there. All participants will be sent a copy of the presentation, and a recording will also be made available on the WorkSafe Queensland website, so keep an eye out for that. We are extremely interested in getting your feedback on these types of sessions, and as Jorgen mentioned, he will be back in the coming weeks for some follow-up sessions, so stay tuned for the invitation for those. So we will leave you now. Thank you for participating, and if you have 2 minutes to complete a survey, we'd love your comments and your feedback. Thanks very much.